This week at the Internet Cafe, equality on the net. Teenagers get the same respect as grown-ups on the net, especially when they run their own site. You do need money to go online, but Plugged In is a community group that helps disadvantaged people gain access to the net. Can you imagine what it's like to navigate the web if you're blind? We'll show you some websites that make it easier. And small political action groups can have the clout of the big boys when they go online to advocate for minority interests. Plus free software on our Cyber Blast, an educational game called Cultural Awareness, and WinSpeech, a program for the sight impaired that will read web pages to you. Equality on the net, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet here with Jane Wither, Andrew DeVries. We're at CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California, in the heart of the Silicon Valley, talking about equality on the net. I guess everybody's seen that famous New Yorker cartoon where the two dogs are, one dog's at a terminal and he's on a chat session. He says to the other dog, on the net, they don't know you're a dog. And I guess the point is there is a certain sort of equalizing factor on the net because we can sort of hide behind that anonymity so people who might not have access or may not be able to do certain things can do it. You agree or disagree? Everybody's just quietly nodding.
I kind of don't really agree. I've worked with a lot of inner city kids, and I have not seen them really have the access and also the skills that are necessary to really take full advantage. Things we take for granted, even just basics like typing or how to format a simple resume. You know, there's a lot of people.
So on the money side, you're saying there's still inequality because you need resources.
Sure, on the money and just also on the educational side of things.
You need to be literate. You need to be able to read. That's one big thing. I mean, even my grand, my mother, for example, never learned how to type on a keyboard. So here's an example of a lady who's got all the tools but doesn't know how to utilize it except maybe one finger at a time.
Good point.
And if it's not easy to use, then clearly she's not going to do it.
Well, we're going to talk to some people today and get their ideas anyhow on how much equality or equal access they have on the net. So equality on the Internet tonight at the Internet Cafe.
Okay, guys, I want you to know that my whole world changed today after you showed me Plug-In. Now, this is on AOL. This is an important thing for everybody to know. So if you're on AOL, you can have a look at Plug-In. It's brand new. And this is a forum for teens. And now, DaMeila, you're one of the cast members on the team. Now, tell me, just explain to me, if I was a teenager going to AOL and got to this forum, what kind of things would I see there?
First, you'll see our faces. and then, like, you... On the front page, it will have chat, it will have boards, it will have like the poll, it will have the cast.
Now what's the poll?
The poll is, it's audio poll, and it's basically what it is whatever our topic is on for the week, like say body piercing, we'll have a question for body piercing, like would mom approve if we didn't ask her, or you know, something like that. It's just, and then each person on the team will give their opinion exactly on what they will say, and then what you could do as a member, you could just go and then check which one, vote for the one that you want, that you like the best.
Right.
So, and then that's what it's like, a vote.
Poll. So you sort of search the percentages of people that responded and said, yeah, that was the right response and stuff like that. That's kind of cool. So you get a track. Now, the interesting thing was also the whole idea of what these topics are about. So, like, one of them was body piercing. The other one's ebonics, which I think is a really hot topic right now.
Uh-huh.
And so, now, what kind of things were people talking about the ebonics topic?
About ebonics, well, one thing people seem to talk about the most is the misconception. Like, what a lot of people think is that they're going to teach ebonics in Oakland City School District, or that's what one of the misconceptions is. And that's really not what it is. What the reason why the ebonics teaching union came up is to teach the teachers so they'll be able to relate to the student. Because a student comes up to a teacher and is speaking ebonics, the teacher isn't going to be able to understand it.
Right.
Also, vice versa. The way the teachers speak, which is standard English, the student isn't going to be able to understand. So it's kind of like vice versa, so that the teacher, if he or she'll learn how to speak ebonics, they'll be able to communicate better. And
so you're on common ground, so you guys can figure out why you didn't be able to get your homework done the night before instead of having an argument about the fact you didn't get it done.
And then the teacher will also be able to help the student, you know, succeed in speaking proper English.
That's really the key, isn't it?
Yeah.
So now, I think one of the interesting things about this whole site is that this is for teens. I mean, you've got a cast of people, and what's the age range on the cast that you work with?
12 to 19.
12 to 19. So that's actually a pretty big range of people that kind of sit down and hammer it out each week. What's going to be the topic, and what are you going to talk about, and how are you going to drive the conversations? Mm-hmm. Now, with the team of people that you've got, you know, how long have you been working together? How long have you been doing this?
About 4 to 5 months now. February, this month being together.
So now, have you, like, before you got on this cast, before you started doing this, had you ever used the internet before?
No.
So this has been kind of an interesting experience.
Very.
Now, would you use the internet if you weren't on the cast and it was just because it was there, would you use it?
I don't think so.
Really? How come?
I mean, because like I said before, I've never been on the internet, and so like if I was never introduced to this job, I think I still wouldn't be affiliated with the internet because I don't know nothing about it. But now that I do know so much about it, now that I've got this job,
it kind of changed the way you do things. Does it make doing homework easier?
A lot easier, a lot. You could do it from a desk at your house or anything.
I mean,
you just don't have to go to the library, research magazines, books, encyclopedias. I mean, all you have to do is just look up.
So it's amazing. So now the trick is to make sure everybody else knows just what a great tool it is.
Yep.
Hopefully this plugin will help do that. Thanks very much for your time, DaMeila.
Hi, I'm Dave Proctor with SVPAL, Silicon Valley Public Access Link. We're a community internet service provider, completely volunteer run. We have very, very low prices, and we invite you to contact us at our website, www.svpal.org.
So, Muki, you're one of the directors at Plugged In, which seems like a community sort of empowerment organization, a youth organization, bringing the internet and technology to people in the community. You guys started in East Palo Alto, and I think you have some pretty interesting correlation or division between East Palo Alto and sort of the rest of Palo Alto, Silicon Valley. How did you guys sort of come about here?
Well, really, East Palo Alto is a very significant community. It's a really economically disenfranchised community. And because of the recent economic boom in Silicon Valley, it's also a digitally disenfranchised community.
So the boom, in a sense, almost kind of
skipped over us.
Yeah,
exactly.
Just missed it. Yeah.
It's a lower income community, primarily minority community.
Mm-hmm.
4 years ago, it had one of the highest murder rates in the country.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. People don't think that. They think Silicon Valley.
Exactly.
They think, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah,
and being right on the fringes of Silicon Valley and not really being able to take part of the digital revolution going on, I think Plugged In's role was to step in and see if we could be a bridge to bringing East Palo Alto into the revolution that's going on.
Right, and I think you guys were started like in 1992.
Yeah.
So 4 years from that, now where do you stand? What kind of programs are you offering, and are you seeing that you're making an impact?
We're definitely seeing that we're making an impact. We provide free access to technology with about 40 computers all hooked to the internet.
To various portions of the community.
To various portions of the community, from 6-year-olds all the way to 70-year-olds. We're open 7 days a week for 70 hours a week.
Wow.
We work with teens. We actually have teen businesses, actually, a web design business.
Where they're actually making money off, mm-hmm. off helping other folks.
Yeah.
Great.
Exactly.
So web design, what types of things are they designing?
Designing web pages for people like Amnesty International.
Oh,
they have
so
about 13
big,
clients.
Big names.
Yeah.
Excellent. And what other kinds of businesses?
We have a desktop publishing business. Yeah. We've done some work for Hewlett Packard, other big Silicon Valley corporations.
So you are sort of bridging that gap that way as well. Now, is this a business where teens actually go in and really run the whole thing, bid on the projects? And
they do. They do that. They sit down with the client, they discuss the price, discuss what type of project it is, and that way they also get exposure to the environment of working in Silicon Valley and get an impression of what it's like.
Do you make them wear ties?
We do sometimes. you know, we make them dress
that's
right.
Cruel.
And, yeah.
Cruel. Yeah, that's really important. And so it's not only the technology, it's also the business side
it's also
of things.
It's life skills.
Right.
It's mentoring them so they can understand what it's like to work in this environment, how
that's
to be professional.
Excellent, excellent. And now you've also said you're kind of branching out and you're hitting other segments of the community with some of your programs. What are those all about?
We have a community networking project called EPA Net. and that stands for East Palo Alto Network.
Okay.
What that is bringing the services Plugged In provides outside of our building and into the community.
So that means reaching out to, is it like nonprofits and things
exactly,
like that?
Other nonprofits, the schools, the city government itself, actually helping them to get online and integrate communications technology.
So are you actually helping them design websites?
We have. We actually have built websites for about 18 other agencies. We actually have the city council meeting agenda online, calendar,
great.
Things like that.
So you're not even just helping them design it, you're actually helping them host these,
Exactly. We host them as well.
Great. So what do you kind of see as the future of all this? Where is it going for your organization?
Well, I really think it's going towards seeing how technology can really be used as a force for community building. How can we assist other agencies in the community in doing the work they're doing through using technology?
Right.
For example, we work with a drug recovery program across the street, and we actually have their clients come to our site and write about the process of going through recovery using the technology. So through that process, they learn how to use a word processor, they learn how to do desktop publishing. That might actually help them get a job somewhere down the line.
Right, so they actually take what they learn there and they're distributing it back within their own
exactly.
group and distributing it out in the
exactly.
community. Sounds excellent. Thank you
Thanks.
Very much.
All right.
The majority of Rwandans who fled last year's rebel offensive ended up here. With water but no food, the amount of relief food flown in is around a third of what's needed to keep everyone alive. 2 months of hunger is taking its toll, in adults and even more so among children.
Lisa, we're talking about equality on the web and kind of equal access to the web, and you deal with people who have disabilities of one sort or another. It's kind of a good news, bad news story in terms of what's going on the web, isn't it?
Well, people are very concerned about how the web is developing and will it erect barriers that eliminate large numbers of people from using it, from using the most important technology that's come along in a long time.
So the good news is there's this great technology that can equalize access, and the bad news is what?
Well, that sites will be created with features that just eliminate whole groups of people.
Like what?
Well, if images become all and people don't use text as well, then that leaves out people who are using screen readers.
And what's a screen reader?
Well, people that are visually impaired want the screen read to them by the technology.
So they can read words, but you can't read pictures, obviously.
Right.
So this whole graphics mania is making it difficult for people who depend on special tools to do that. Now, you can design a website up front, can't you, to make it more accessible or less accessible to people who have some limitations. Give us examples of what's a really good website from that point of view and what's a bad website.
Okay. The Alliance for Technology Access has tried to design a model site. So when they have a picture, they'll also have a caption right under it that describes what's in it.
So the screen reader could read that.
Or if your vision wasn't just quite good enough. And actually, you get more information that way. It's quite interesting. The other suggestion for websites is if they start using real audio or some kind of talking thing, make sure that that information is also presented in writing.
Now, what's an example of a badly designed website from your point of view?
A bad website would be one that's using so many graphics, and for some reason they've decided maybe to give you an alternative, like a text-only page,
right.
But instead of putting that tag in text, they put it in a graphic only. So
the text alternative isn't a graphic, so you never get to it. It's kind of a catch-22.
Yeah.
All right, now you have your own site, the Center for Accessible Technology, is it? And what kind of information, what resources would I find out about there?
Well, the Center for Accessible Technology is concerned with how you can use standard technology if you can't use a keyboard or a mouse, or if you need some assistance. We were doing a class today with an extra large cursor on the screen for some of the kids.
Uh-huh. So for people with physical impairments, you might have assistance in specialized keyboards or cursor control devices.
And if somebody had a developmental disability, you could set up a home page that didn't require literacy. There's a lot of things.
That's right. All right, now you have one special site there I looked at called Plain Math, which is really interesting. Tell us what the point is of that.
The Plain Math Project is math for 4th through 7th graders with an aeronautics background.
So it's plain, P-L-A-N-E.
Yeah, and we're putting curriculum on the web in a way that is maximally accessible. You wouldn't have to use a keyboard to enter an answer. You could just choose it on the screen. The navigation is pretty simple.
What's cool, too, it's not only teaching math, but it really presents role models and says to a kid, if you have some disabilities, no big deal. You can be an aeronautical engineer, too, right?
Yes, we found disabled pilots, engineers, and their profiles are up there, and they're talking to the kids about why you need to have the math to get into those careers.
And it's an open website. If I'm a teacher, I can just go onto it and use it for my students,
too,
right?
It's good for everybody. I think everybody would find it a better site because it's simpler, and because if you design with people with disabilities in mind, then your site is suddenly useful by everyone.
Now, there's a lot of activism going on in the disabled community now to make sure this web stuff doesn't get out of hand and go crazy with the multimedia and the graphics, huh?
People have an opportunity to get in on the ground floor and say, this is universal design. If you think about people with disabilities and you design it, then your mother or you when you get older or anyone is going to find it more usable.
So again, that's a broad term, those disabilities, right? We're talking about normal people who are going to have problems seeing a screen or moving a fine little cursor and so on. So it really is worth including all these people if we want equal access.
Right, like the person who just started to use a mouse and it's still new for them. They might not be able to hit a little target.
Lisa, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
On this Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 5 software programs. We'll be downloading to you more than 4 megabytes of code in less than 120 seconds. You can actually see the data downloading right now. It's the stuff right over here. So to get these files this fast through the TV signal, you need an add-on card for your computer called a TV modem. We'll tell you more about that later. You can also download these files through our website using your regular telephone modem. Download time on the phone at 288 will be about half an hour. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, an educational game called Cultural Awareness. This is about a 200K file that's a great game for children and adults. It covers a wide range of topics and it helps you improve your cultural literacy. Second, we're going to send you a program called WinSpeech. This is one of several available text-to-speech programs that can help people with visual impairment by having the text on their computer screens read to them. Then an interesting program called MyWay. It's a personalized web browser plugin for people who tend to spend a lot of time on certain websites. This will make it easy for you to personalize and customize your browser and speed up the process of going to your favorite sites. Finally, just for the fun of it, 2 classic games for the kids. The original Mario Brothers game for the PC and the original Pac-Man ported over to the PC. Remember, we're sending all 5 programs to you right now through the television signal using our CyberBlast technology. The speed of this download is more than 300 kilobits per second, so it's a lot faster than using a 288 or even a 33.6 modem. If you need information on how to receive a CyberBlast or on how to buy or install a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. You'll also find information there on how to download these files directly from the net using this lower telephone modem. So, looks like the download is just about complete. Have fun with your new software. That wraps up this CyberBlast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Giles Bateman.
So, Annalisa, you have produced a documentary, Unauthorized Access, which was a sharp look at the hacker culture. And you're sort of an expert on subversive, marginalized groups, subcultures, things like that.
Yeah. Well, I hope so. I try to be.
Okay. The Internet has come along now, and basically there's groups that are able to get messages out there. What are some of the groups that are using the Internet that, you know, may not have had access before?
Well, it's interesting because there's groups like, say, like the Hacker Underground or Tupac Amura, the people that have taken over the Japanese embassy in Peru.
Right, that's still going on, actually.
Yeah, the Zapatistas, which is a Mexican revolutionary group.
Right.
There's all kinds of groups like AIM, the American Indian Movement, who are putting stuff out there. And it's quite interesting because up until now, it was very hard to get your message out there to a lot of different people and all over the world.
Right.
So now you can do, even Amnesty International is doing certain movements over the internet because they find it easy to communicate over a broader range of people.
Now, are these folks mostly using this technology to get their message out to their own people, or are they trying to get the message out to the world, or both?
Both. I think in the instance of the American Indian Movement, I think that's really interesting because it's certain Native American tribes communicating with each other, and I don't think it's as much for going out there to the general American populace.
So it's a real inter group
thing,
communication
tool. I think it's also interesting too that for say in the instance of the Zapatistas or even Tupac Amura, it's not necessarily the groups themselves that put the information on the net, but people that support those groups.
So
they think,
outside,
you know, the Zapatistas are doing something really good, or they really support Che Guevara, the, you know, revolutionary from who helped in the Cuba overthrow back in the 60s. So So they just think it's really a good thing, so they'll put the information up there.
Further and then, the cause along the way.
There's some a hacker group that I actually went and filmed in Germany a couple years ago, and they did something really interesting, which was to go to the war zone in Sarajevo. Mm. And what they did was they put up a BBS system.
A bulletin board,
an electronic bulletin board system where people could post messages and email people back and forth and talk to each other, which from both sides, so the Serbian and the Croatian side, they could use the bulletin board system and they could tell each other what was going on. And over a democratic medium like the internet, you know, if you're just typing in text, who's going to know whether you're Serbian or Croatian? Right. It's all about what you're saying.
And the point being that during a war like that, and especially in those countries, most of the media was being controlled by one
either
military group or another.
Whoever had power at the time.
Right.
It was also interesting when the coup in Russia, when Yeltsin, back when Yeltsin did the coup against Gorbachev, there was a group that was able to take information and post it onto the net quite quickly about what was going on, and that Yeltsin was, you know, trying to take over.
Right.
So it's a way to disseminate information very quickly to a large number of people. But then you have to be very careful because, you know, propaganda is one thing and also disinformation. So it's just as easy to put out disinformation as information.
Right. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Jane, I want to follow up on the conversation we had at the matter of fact, what you were saying at the beginning of the show, which really made me think that there are things which prevent equal access to the web, which I don't even think about because I just take them for granted. Like you talked about being able to use a typewriter or a keyboard, being able to read. I mean, this is basic stuff that really does prevent people from getting access to the web.
It's kind of ironic, too, because a lot of the people who would benefit most from getting access to some of this have the inability to get past the barrier.
So you can learn, you know, literacy skills on
the
web, but you can't get there. It's kind of a catch-22 thing.
Exactly.
Or even just sort of technophobia, right? I mean, I like to get my mother on the web. I keep on talking about it. It's just intimidating. Well, computers and all the stuff I can't deal with because I've never dealt with
Well, my mom doesn't know how to use the keyboard. Yeah. So I put it down in front of her, and she just said, well, what am I supposed to do with this?
Yeah. I want to mention one thing. When I was talking to Lisa about people with disabilities, she mentioned screen readers. I just want people watching to know you actually can download a screen reader called PW WebSpeak, which actually is a voice-activated browser, I guess, which actually talks and reads the words to you. So even if you have sight problems, which doesn't mean you're disabled, it could be anybody.
Just or you're dyslexic.
So you can actually get that software online.
I think, you know, one of the things from my perspective is if it is open access, then wouldn't it be better if something like Netscape, for example, had that capability built in?
Yeah, I mean, why don't these browsers, Explorer and Netscape, just have this stuff be broader than
Because, especially with people with disabilities, computers allow them to do so many more things. It's just a much better way for them to be able
There's another point you mentioned, which I think is worth saying, too, that people, when I think about equal access, I still think about the two-thirds of the people in this country or the 90% of the people around the world who've never accessed the web. I mean, there's no equality of access there because they don't know what it's about. They don't know what they're going to get from it.
It's all about, I mean, how many people do you talk to and they go, yeah, you know, I really have to get into that internet thing.
Yeah.
But it's like, why would you want to do that unless there was something specifically that you wanted to do?
There's still
it's
a long
tool.
Way to go with this net stuff.
Right.
Andrew, after meeting some of the people here in the CyberSmith Cafe tonight, you still think what you said at the very beginning, that there really isn't equality on the net?
Yeah, I still think so. I see some great groups, you know, doing some very exciting things and gaining access, but unfortunately these are nonprofit groups, and I don't think yet they have the ability to extend out far enough in the community.
But it's better than not having the net, isn't it?
You're right.
I
but
mean, it's some improvement.
You're right, but I'll tell you, you know, I was at a big computer conference this week in San Francisco, and as I looked out over the audience of the 2,000 people that were sitting there, it was primarily a sea of Caucasian faces. So I still think that there is some, you know, inequality going on in the industry and I think out on the internet.
A lot. Yeah. There's still a lot. I think the one thing for me, in talking to DaMeila, and then we didn't even have a chance to talk to Sheva, and she had so much more to say about just building this group of these cast members between the ages of 12 and 20. I mean, these kids, a lot of them had never used a computer, let alone been on the internet. And now they're building this AOL forum for teens. And, you know, in talking to them, their whole world changed. I mean, once they got access.
Well, to your point, you need a purpose.
Right.
To do all that stuff.
Exactly.
One point I would make on the basic equality issue, like the beginning we talked about, you know, they don't know if you're a dog when you're on the net. With all this multimedia, with all the digital photos going on, with all the sound and everything, I think that whole anonymity thing, which really furthered the equality, is going away. So I think once we get to see everybody and hear everybody, we're going to have the same darn prejudices we have in the real world, and the net's not going to really be an equal active force.
We may find some real dogs, too.
Dogs on the net. All right, that's it for this week's Internet Cafe. We'll see you here next time.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor. Videotapes of the Internet Cafe are available for $24.95 each. To order your copy, call 1-800-916-PCTV. We'll help you stay on top of the rapidly changing world of computers and personal technology. Call today for your copy of this episode of the Internet Cafe or any of our other award-winning programs. When ordering, please ask for tapes by show number and title. That's 1-800-916-PCTV.